Hello everyone, welcome to today's lecture, Irrigants and Intracanal Medicaments. Coming to topic learning outcomes, list ideal properties of root canal irrigants, list different types of root canal irrigants and discuss their properties, describe the needles and techniques used for irrigation, discuss the properties and role of chelating agents, list the ideal properties of intracanal medicaments, list different intracanal medicaments, discuss the properties and role of intracanal medicaments. Ideal properties of irrigant. It should have broad spectrum antimicrobial properties, aid in debridement of the root canal system, ability to dissolve necrotic tissue or debris, low toxicity levels, good lubricant, low surface tension to flow into inaccessible areas of root canal, ability to sterilize the canal, prevent or dissolve smear layer, and inactivate endotoxins. Commonly used irrigating solutions. They are basically divided into chemically non-active solution and chemically active. So chemically non-active solution, water, saline and local anesthetic. Chemically active materials that includes alkalis, example sodium hypochlorite, chelating agent that is EDTA, oxidizing agent hydrogen peroxide, antibacterial agent chlorhexidine, acids 30% hydrochloric acid, enzymes streptokinase pepain, and detergent that is sodium lauryl sulfate. So these all are the chemically non-active solution and chemically active materials used for irrigating canals. Next is sodium hypochlorite, which is also called as Daikin solution, because Henry Daikin, which is introduced to treat the wounds during World War I. Later, Grossman demonstrated the tissue dissolving capacity of sodium hypochlorite in 1941. At body temperature, the reactive chlorine in aqueous solution exists in two forms, that is sodium hypochlorite and hypochlorous acid. Chlorine depends upon the pH of the solution, that is above pH of 7.6, it is mainly hypochlorite. Whereas below this pH, it is hypochlorous acid. So the presence of free chlorine in sodium hypochlorite is responsible for breakdown of protein into amino acids. And 1% sodium bicarbonate is added as a buffering agent to increase the efficacy of sodium hypochlorite. So that is about the mechanism of action of sodium hypochlorite. Methods to increase the efficacy of sodium hypochlorite. First one is time. So the antimicrobial effect of the sodium hypochlorite is directly related to the contact time. That is, the greater the contact time, the more effective it is. Second is heat. Warming of sodium hypochlorite solution to 60 to 70 degree Celsius increases the efficacy of sodium hypochlorite. So studies have proven it. So that is one thing about heating. Then specialized irrigating syringes, that is side venting endodontic syringes with narrower diameter, helps irrigant to move sideways. Basically, if there is a side vented needles, if you push the irrigant into the canal, the irrigant will push the debris through the sides of the canal to the outside. Then comes the ultrasonic activation. It accelerates the chemical reaction, creates the cavitational effect, and thus causing superior cleansing action. Coming to the precautions, should be always performed passively. Syringe should never lock in the canal. Basically, you should irrigate the canal passively, because if you give active pressure inside the canal, that might cause pain. Secondly, there will be pushing of solution towards the apex, or it crosses the apex and it causes serious damage, and it will end up in excruciating pain and bleeding and swelling. So to avoid this, canal should be irrigated passively. And medications can be given if it occurs. So first, if the sodium hypochlorite is gone beyond the apex, irrigate the canal with saline, lot of saline, make sure the remnants are removed from the canal. Once it is done, close the canal. Ideally, you should be irrigating the canal for nearly 20 minutes. Once it is done, after that, you can close it. Then advise the patient to take antibiotics, painkillers and antihistamines to prevent the potential spread of infection as well as to reduce the pain. So that's about sodium hypochlorite. Next is hydrogen peroxide. It is a clear, odorless liquid mainly used as 3%. It is highly unstable and rapidly dissociates into water and nascent oxygen. The liberated nascent oxygen produces a bactericidal effect when coming in contact with tissue enzymes, and it diminishes in the presence of organic debris. It also causes oxidation of bacterial enzymes and thus interferes with the bacterial metabolism. Also, the rapid release of nascent oxygen on contact with the organic tissue causes a bubbling action which helps in the mechanical debridement of the canal. So nowadays, hydrogen peroxide is not commonly used in irrigation, but previously it was used because of its bubbling action when it comes in contact with the organic debris. Chlorhexidine. It is a potent antiseptic widely used for plaque control in concentration of 0.1% to 0.2%. Optimal microbial action between pH 5 to 7 as an irrigant at 2%. Then mechanism of action, broad spectrum antimicrobial agent, lower concentration causes leakage of intracellular components, that is bacteriostatic, and higher concentration it is bactericidal. Substantivity, residual antimicrobial activity for 72 hours. So the mechanism of chlorhexidine, the positively charged chlorhexidine molecule attracts the negatively charged bacterial cell wall and it causes the leakage of intracellular components and thereby it causes cell lysis. That is how the mechanism of chlorhexidine. So next is EDTA. So it is a chelating agent to remove smear layer containing microorganism. It is non-toxic, used at a neutral pH. Functions are lubrication, emulsification, holding debris in suspension and smear layer removal. So it inhibits the growth of bacteria and ultimately destroys them by starvation, as EDTA chelates with the metallic ions in the medium which are needed for growth of microorganism. It also forms a stable bond with the calcium and dissolved dentin. When an equilibrium is reached, further dissolution does not occur. There are different forms of EDTA, that is R-EDTA, in which cetrimide is added. It helps in better cleaning of canals. The other one is EDTA-T, that is combination of texapon, that helps to reduce the surface tension. Then EDTA-C, that contains cetavalon, has a disinfecting properties and also reduce the contact angle of EDTA when placed on dental surfaces, thus enhancing cleaning activity. So basically EDTA is used to remove the smear layer, and certain times if the canal is calcified, EDTA is used to go or is to use to get the canal pattern. Sometimes it works, it has a dissolving capacity of dentin, thereby it acts on the calcified canal surfaces. Next is MTAD. It is a mixture of tetracycline acid and a detergent. So basically it is a mixture of antibiotic, a chelating agent and a detergent. So tetracycline, sometimes doxycycline is also used, and acid is citric acid and detergent is Twins 80. So citric acid eliminates the smear layer, allowing the tetracycline or doxycycline to pass into the dental tubules and cause the antibacterial effect. This is one other irrigant commonly used, but it is an expensive one, so that not everyone is using it. So the basically, if you talk about the irrigating solutions we use, we come across saline, which is the cheap and commonly used by a dentist. Then comes the sodium hypochlorite, then ADTA, then comes the chloroxidine. So basically these all are the four commonly used one in clinics. Okay, next is irrigation devices and techniques. So the conventional technique is syringe and needles. So basically, you know how it is done. We have to load the solution into the syringe, and with the help of the needle it is delivered into the canal. So few improvements are there. So we can call it as side vented needles or thinner gauge needles, we can say. So side vented needles, the solution will be delivered through the sides of the needle instead of the tip, and the thinner gauge ones, it is much more flexible and you can place it much more deeper to the canal and you can irrigate so that the debris can flush out easily. Then comes the endo actuator. It is based on a sonic vibration of a plastic tip in the root canal. Then endovac, it is a negative pressure approach system which is placed into the pulp chamber and creates a negative pressure at the apex, and specially made needles, it is taken out from the canal. So the first one is endo actuator. It is based on sonic vibration up to 10,000 rpm of a plastic tip in the root canal. The system has three different size of tips that are easily attached to the handpiece and creates sonic vibration. The use of endo actuator facilitates the irrigant penetration and mechanical cleansing compared with needle irrigation, and with no increase in risk of irrigant extrusion through the apex. So basically, because of the sonic system, it creates a better cleaning of the canal. Next one is endovac. So basically it has a master delivery tip, macro cannula and a micro cannula. The master delivery tip continuously supplies the solution to the canal. Macro cannula, which is used to remove the solution and debris from the coronal surface of the canal, whereas micro cannula, which has small openings on the syringe or the needle, where it creates a negative pressure and takes out the debris and the solution from the apical part of the canal. So that is how it works. You can see the first one is the master delivery tip. It continuously delivers the solution. Second one, macro cannula. So it creates the negative pressure and take out the solution from the canal, and micro cannula, which creates again negative pressure and take out the debris and solution from the apical part of the canal. So that's all about the irrigation. So next is intracanal medicaments. So the ideal requirements of a intracanal medicament: it should be an effective germicide and fungicide. It should be not irritating to the periapical tissues. It should remain stable in solution. It should have prolonged antimicrobial effect. It should be active in the presence of blood, serum and protein derivatives of tissue. It should have low surface tension and easily diffusible. It should not interfere with repair of periapical tissues, and it should not stain the tooth structure. So these all are the ideal properties of intracanal medicaments. So coming to the classification of intracanal medicaments: essential oils, phenolic compounds, calcium hydroxide, halogens, chloroxidine gluconate, antibiotics, chloroxidine and antibiotic combination. So first one, phenolic compounds, one of the oldest antimicrobial agent, and it is a disinfectant also, and toxicity and possible mutagenicity. Optimal bacterial effect is at 1 to 2%. Derivatives of phenols are stronger antiseptics and toxins than phenol. So phenol, as we said, it's a good disinfection solution for periapical surgery, and it's also used to as a cauterizing tissue tag that resists removal with brooches or files. Then the derivatives of phenol has high toxicity and it is irritating to periapical tissues sometimes. So basically these materials are not used much in a clinical setup because their clinical efficacy is unpredictable, but it can be used as a best potent antimicrobial agents at laboratory test conditions. So that is what we can talk about the phenol compounds. Then comes the aldehydes. They are water soluble protein, denaturing agents, potent disinfectants, but they are highly toxic, mutagenic, carcinogenic. And derivatives are formocrazole and paraformaldehyde. They are good for the pulpotomy. Previously they used to fix the pulp for histological evaluation, but because of its high toxicity, these aldehydes are not much used as a intracranial medicaments. For your understanding, you can understand about the potential benefits of using aldehydes. Basically, when you are doing a pulpotomy treatment, formocrazole were used previously. Nowadays its use is not that much advised because of the possible high toxicity. Nowadays MTA can be used, that is biocompatible, and gives good result as well. So the best one we can talk about as an intracranial medicament is calcium hydroxide, introduced by Hermann in 1920. So it is one of the commonly used intracranial medicament. It is a broad spectrum antimicrobial agent, and its action probably relates to its high pH and its leaching action onto the necrotic pulp tissue. So mechanism of action: damage to the bacterial cytoplasmic membrane, protein denaturation, and damage to the DNA. That's how it acts upon the bacteria. So it is best used in weeping canals where there is a constant clear or reddish exudate associated with large periapical lesion. It is available in powder and paste. That is, you have to take the powder and mix with saline, or nowadays it is mixed with chlorhexidine solution and placed into the canal with the help of a lenticular spiral. It's an instrument which is which can be used to place the material or the any type of fluid, not exactly fluids, it's a slurry consistency you have to make, and after that you have to load it to the lenticular spiral, then with a slow speed you have to place it inside the canal, or else you can use with the help of a file, coat it onto the file and place into the canal. That is what we used previously, but nowadays easy methods are there. It is available in the form of syringe. So basically, like irrigating, you have to make sure it is about 2 to 3 mm, or for at least 4 to 5 mm from the apex, periapex. Make sure it is not locked inside the canal, then slowly give a pressure and place the medicament inside the canal, and after that you place the cotton pellet, then put the temporary restoration. That is about the calcium hydroxide. Next is chlorhexidine gluconate. It is a broad spectrum antimicrobial agent, already we discussed in irrigants, and it is also shown to be an excellent intracranial medicament. Its action may be due to sustained release of chemical. Studies have shown that calcium hydroxide and chlorhexidine combination was more effective. Chlorhexidine is active against a wide range of aerobic and anaerobic bacteria as well as candida species. Effective concentration in range of 0.2 to 2%. Basically we are using 2%, which is because studies have shown that 2% chlorhexidine is best for the antimicrobial activity. Antibiotics: PBSC paste, that is penicillin, bacitracin, streptomycin, and caprolate. Later the sodium caprolate is been replaced with nystatin, so it is known as PBSN. So penicillin is effective against gram positive, bacitracin against penicillin resistant microorganisms, streptomycin for gram negative organism, and caprolate for fungi. So it is injected into the root canal or impregnated onto the paper points. Sulfonamides are also used as a intracranial medicament. Previously it mixed with the distilled water and placed into the canals. It is supposed to be a good intracranial medicaments in periapical abscess conditions, but it causes yellow discoloration of the tooth. Nowadays it is not been used, but antibiotics are still used nowadays. So coming to the corticosteroid antibiotic combination, so highly effective in treatment of overinflammation. That means when you work beyond the apex, there will be severe pain. it's placed into the inflamed tissue by a paper point or a reamer to be effective. It reduces the periapical inflammation and gives instant relief of the pain. Antibiotic constituents are present so that the overgrowth of the microorganism will be prevented. So basically, if you do over instrumentation, the best way to control pain is placement of corticosteroids and antibiotics to reduce the infection. Next is placement of intracanal medicament. Copiously irrigate the canal to remove the debris present. So once the cleaning and sheeping is completed, irrigate the canal nicely and make sure there is no debris. After that, use the master apical file to check the patency of the canal. Then you can dry the canal using absorbent paper points. Then you can introduce the intracanal medicament either using a lidular spiral, because if you are using a powder and liquid, you have to use a lidular spiral, or you can use a reamer and insert the material inside the canal. For example, if you are using a calcicure, which is available in our clinics, you can just inject into the canal. So loosely, that is not active. Passively, you just insert the needle and into the canal, then you just inject. So once the overflow is coming, you can place a small cotton roll on top of the pulp chamber, then you place the temporary filling and close it. Limitations of intracanal medicaments. So first one, intracanal environment. The therapeutic action of these intracanal medicaments depends on the direct contact of tissues. Secondly, duration. To be effective, these agents should remain chemically active during the time of inter appointments. Phenols lose their activity very quickly, within 24 hours. Calcium hydroxide retains the antimicrobial action for a prolonged period. So basically, you all know that bacteria are the major cause for the pulpal and periapical diseases. So in order to reduce the bacterial population inside the infected root canal, you have to do a thorough cleaning and shaping. After that, you have to do a good irrigation. Then you place a very good intracanal medicament to attain this. So there are different types of irrigating solutions available. So commonly used one is saline. And if you are using the irrigating solutions with a very good antimicrobial efficacy, that is better. For example, you can use the chloroxidine, then 2% you have to use. Then you can use, if there is a vital tissue involved in it, you can use the sodium hypochlorite and EDTA. So irrigant should be always a combination of sodium hypochlorite, chloroxidine and EDTA. And when you talk about the intracanal medicaments, the commonly used one is calcium hydroxide and chloroxidine as well. So you can use a combination of these two. You can get the best results. Either the irrigants or the intracanal medicaments, none of these has all of the characteristics of a ideal irrigant or a ideal intracanal medicament. So you have to know where to use which one. So as I said, if there is a vital pulp, it is better to use the sodium hypochlorite, then take out the vital component. After that, for better antimicrobial activity, the canal should be irrigated last with chloroxidine solution. Then once it is done, you can move on to the next stage, that is the placement of intracanal medicament. So you can use either calcium hydroxide or you can use chloroxidine. So a combination of this will give you a better result, and we will continue to do the search for an ideal material or a technique to completely clean the infected root canals. Thank you.